Good morning, everyone. I really appreciate you all joining me here at 8 a.m. on a Wednesday to come listen about the realities of enterprise blockchain. My name is Adam Cecchetti. I'm the founder and CEO of Deja Security. We're an application and hardware penetration testing firm located in Seattle, Washington. I'm hoping that you leave with two key takeaways today. One is some of the ideas around where an enterprise can use blockchain and what some of the valid use cases for blockchain in enterprises are. And two, some of the fundamentals behind the technologies that make up enterprise blockchain systems. Now, this talk's going to take a little bit of an interesting journey, and I'm glad you're joining me on this, because we're going to snake across 6,000 years of time and history to be able to understand exactly where some of these technologies have come from, as well as then to kind of project into the future of, you know, how we might use these technologies across different organizations and across different use cases. So I'm a little bit of a fan of history. I remember sitting in history class as a boy, about 10 years old, and listening to stories about Marco Polo trading across Asia, looking for things like spice and silk and coin, and meeting new people and interacting with new cultures. I also remember reading about the Assyrian traders who would go across Mesopotamia from one city-state to the next, going across language boundaries and trying to have commerce and trade, but at the same time having no central authority, having no central city-state that was one governing rule of laws. Now, as it turns out, the Assyrians created a technology to solve a little bit of this problem. They were one of the first ones to sit down and say, we need to be able to trust and verify the transactions that we're performing in some kind of distributed manner without a central set of laws or a central set of individuals that would govern the way that we perform commerce. And they were the ones that would create some of the earliest ledger technology. Clay tablets were the origin of ledger technology. They're estimated to be about 5,000 plus years old. They're a fork of the DIRT project, if you're tracking the height of technology at that time. They would record transactions using a sharpened stick in either early cuneiform, middle, or late cuneiform. And you'd bake them between 500 and 600 degrees over a fire to mint one of these tablets, to mint one of these records of transactions. Now, after you would stack a few of these up, you'd have a pretty long ongoing chain of record of the trade that happened across Mesopotamia. So an interesting thing happened is they had so many clay tablets they'd actually start to make indexes or codexes of which clay tablet they wanted to reference for which transaction, for which trade, at which point in time. These things have a little bit of a downside. If you want to erase the record, you simply shatter the tablet. They have incredibly high latency, sometimes in the range of either months or years, and incredibly low throughput. They are difficult, but not impossible to forge. You simply had to be literate somewhere around 5,000 years ago. Now, no small task, but also not an impossible task if you wanted to create a fake clay tablet. Since the very beginning of our ledger technology, they have not been privacy preserving. Recently, a stockpile of 12,000 of these clay tablets was unearthed in Mesopotamia, and it detailed the trade transactions across all of the trade routes. And using some clever mathematics and a little bit of archaeology, they were able to reverse engineer forgotten cities and forgotten trade points among different trade routes. So even from the earliest point in our ledger technology, it was not privacy preserving. The ability to figure out who traded where and for what caused us to be able to unearth hidden cities or forgotten lands. Also, entertainingly enough, in one of the tablets they found was a record of a customer service report saying that they had gotten the wrong shipment of copper. So as long as we've been trading with one another, as long as we've been interacting with one another, we've been having customer service issues. So let's talk about blockchain. Blockchain is a transactional ledger of events recording transactions and actions that happen between one set of individuals to another. It's a global set of ordered clay tablets, or a global set of ordered blocks, where you stack up one set of transactions after the other. The difference being that every single time that a block is created on the chain, instead of one person getting a copy of that clay tablet, literally every trader in Mesopotamia would get a copy of that clay tablet, or everybody gets a copy of that block. And the way that they work is the transactions are recorded for being able to denote who will get the next step in the transaction. So if you were to say, he who holds this coin gets a lambskin, or he who can sign this clay tablet gets the two sheep and perhaps a bolt of textile. But the point being is that every single person in the network will get every single copy of every single transaction in the chain. But in reality, what they really are is a flat file database. These are technologies that we've been using for quite a long time. And these flat file databases record all of the transactions in a succinct order. And they're a representation of all of the trades that happen across all of the individuals in that particular chain as a graph of ordered events in time. These databases have gotten fairly large. So if you look at some of the public ones, for instance, Bitcoin or Ethereum, they're in the hundreds of gigabytes or half terabyte range because you need to hold every single transaction for anyone that's ever conducted a transaction across the entire blockchain network. So we used to bake these clay tablets at 500 or 600 degrees in a fire to be able to kind of mint a set of transactions. With blockchain, we have a couple of different ways that we perform this. One for public networks, for instance, Ethereum or Bitcoin, which uses something called a proof of work, using a large number of cryptographic hashes to be able to verify that the transaction in that block is valid. More recently, things like Ethereum and other blockchain networks have been moving towards a proof of stake, which is saying, I have a large amount of stake in this trade network, I have a large amount of stake in this blockchain, so I'm going to lock up a number of my coins, say a few thousand or tens of thousand, to be able to vote on which transactions are valid and which transactions are not valid. Enterprise blockchain systems mostly use a concept called a voting protocol or a consensus protocol, where you only have a number of actors, like say 5 or 100 on a network. You can have a number of those individuals vote to say which transactions are valid. The current blockchain technologies that we have are also not privacy enforcing. So every single transaction that's recorded on one of these is public to every individual on the network. So it's pretty easy to reverse engineer who's transferring what to who, when and how, and maybe potentially why if you can start to identify some of the actors on the chains. It is difficult but not impossible to forge a block in a blockchain, just like one of those clay tablets. You simply need 51% or more of the hashing power of the network, a significant amount of stake in the network, or a significant amount of purchasing power inside of that network, a number of individuals to collude as a cabal to vote on which transactions you want to be valid, or access to the private keys, which is usually when you hear about a trading firm or an individual being hacked via Bitcoin or Ethereum, it's because in some way, shape, or form, they lost control of their private keys. Now, all of these things are difficult, but not impossible. They're about similarly difficulty of about being littered about 4,000 years ago. So where can enterprises use blockchain? The real use case for enterprises in blockchain is where no central authority is either incentivized to exist or can potentially legally exist because of either liability reasons or that nobody wants one to exist. So you could think of something like a supply chain. You have 50 vendors in your supply chain. You want to be able to ensure that all the transactions being conducted within that supply chain are being valid and trusted and verified. But no one vendor of your supply chain wants you or anyone else in that chain to be their central authority. If, for instance, you have a loose confederation of 5 financial institutions, nobody wants to take on the legal responsibility of being the standing record for either SOX compliance or other reasons. But at the same time, they all want to perform some type of transactional trade. They all want to have some type of way of being able to send information to each other, trust, and verify it, but no one be the central point of accountability. Additionally, other places that are very useful for the enterprise blockchain systems are where you need a long-standing audit record, for instance, maintenance records or maintenance or accounting records for some of those transactions that are performing. If you have a high amount of data being transferred from one enterprise organization to the other in a non-transactional manner, say giant engineering files or large media files being traded back and forth, that's not currently a good use case for some of the enterprise blockchain systems. Now, a feature that enterprise blockchain systems have that public ones don't is that they're permissioned. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. And they can also be privacy enforcing if they're correctly utilized, depending on which system there is. Now you might say, Adam, you just told me that blockchain is nothing more than this flat file database. How can it do all of these transactions and all of these other things with permissioned networks and privacy? Well, we're going to have to add a little bit more technology before we get to there. So let's talk about early computing with the mainframe. Early mainframes were primarily flat memory addresses that had very little isolation of data or code, but you could still run a number of different applications across that flat memory space. And for the most part, they were batch processing systems that were multi-user that anyone with an X25 or one of those ARPANET connections could access. Now, interestingly enough, most of the early computing research was done around throughput and being able to process as much data through a mainframe as possible. So let's take a look at what is considered a brand new computer with Ethereum. Ethereum is a Turing-complete virtual machine that runs on top of a peer-to-peer network that is globally accessible by a number of users. It has a flat memory space, meaning that anyone that uses that computer can access any of the data or code inside of it when it's running. It stores programs inside of itself such that they can be called by any other user at any given time and inside of the EVM. And for the most part, a significant amount of the work being done in this new computer is to be able to get as many transactions through as possible, as much data bandwidth through as possible. Now, I mentioned that this computer stores applications. It stores applications in a somewhat familiar way. So early storage technology, ROM, is a number of bits being flipped inside of a chip at manufacture time. It's a storage of data and code. If you know where the ROM chip is in your system, you can access it and call that data, call that program, to enable it to either run the program or give you information back from it. ROM chips are baked at manufacture time, meaning that if you make a mistake, or if when you're building the program inside of it, you mess up, you have to either shatter the chip or destroy it to start over. Now, later ROM technology allowed you to erase them with UV and other reprogrammable, but the very first ones, it was one shot, one program, or go through this whole expensive manufacturing process again. Ethereum and other enterprise blockchain systems use what are called smart contracts. And these smart contracts are simply a collection of data and code, a small application that's distributed out amongst the Ethereum virtual machine or across one of these peer-to-peer blockchain networks. It writes once exactly, and you cannot patch or update it, which means you need to get it perfect the very first time. And it shares some very interesting properties with ROM, is that the only way to destroy that program is to call a special opcode called suicide. So that leads to some very interesting use cases. One of the things that we've created here is a new computer. We have a new computer with a new application model running on a new network. And that EVM has its entire new set of side effects. Every time you create a new computer, you have a new set of side effects. And as a result, you have a new set of security problems. So there are bug classes that exist in these enterprise blockchain systems, in the distributed applications, in the smart contracts that don't exist anywhere else simply because we've built a new computer. So some of the things that we focus on at Deja Vu Security is trying to figure out what some of these interesting side effects are, as well as how they have security implications across either enterprises or for individual users. Additionally, because the computer is so new, there's a lack of good audited examples of code. Just like in the early days of the web or the early days of PC, there's not a large corpus of things to pull off of either Stack Overflow or out of books to say, this is valid smart contract code that's been secure and well-maintained and the right way to do it. The computer is just simply very new. So to recap, Ethereum is a globally accessible computer that runs on top of a peer-to-peer network with a carefully managed set of applications that all run in a flat memory space. These programs, usually referred to as smart contracts or dApps, gate access to the blockchain, which is the database that runs underneath this computer. And the state of both the data and code run across these applications and is stored transactionally in the blockchain. So any single program that's ever run on the Ethereum computer, whether it was published by someone in the United States or someone from anywhere else around the world, that transaction state is recorded on that blockchain for someone else to be able to see. And then just like in the early days of any other computer, we're having the same kind of issues that you normally see, where we're not able to patch these applications. There's no user isolation. There's no data isolation. We're still working on privileges. We're still working on local privileges and some of the other problems like privacy, identity, so on and so forth. If this sounds familiar, it's because history tends to repeat itself here. We had this exact same set of problems with mainframes, with PCs, with web browsers, with mobile phones. In fact, I would hypothesize that even though computers are fantastic at executing the loops that we tell them, it's better. Computers are actually also incredibly good at putting humans like us in a loop. If you don't believe me, look at any office around, any office in the world. You click print on your computer, you walk to the pickle paper robot, it has not done the thing that you want it to do, it sends you back to the computer, and you repeat this until 5 or 7 copies are created. It's a computer's putting humans in a loop. So every time we create a new computer, whether it's a mainframe, a PC, a web browser, or mobile, we create the same set of 10 problems. We end up looping ourselves. And these problems start with determinism, making sure the computer is a computer, reliability, availability, communication, security, distribution, fault tolerance, scalability, isolation, and finally, identity. Every single time we've created a computer, we've created these 10 problems. Now, enterprise blockchain systems and Ethereum and similar systems like them got really good at solving some of the things like reliability, availability, distribution, and fault tolerance, but left things on the table like security, isolation, and identity. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But let's talk about how cross-organization syncing is still done today. If you're at a large enterprise, you know that you have either some type of batch program that SFTP files up to some other company that you're in a partnership with. If you're lucky, there might be some type of REST API or something that ends up getting called to be able to sync information from one organization's database to the other. Some type of batch process runs in the background, picks up those files, pushes them into an Access or Oracle database, and everything's happy until one of those processes gets out of sync. And then two people get on the phone, and they look at whatever row or entry in there, assuming it's been caught within a couple of weeks or a couple of months later, and they manually edit that 4 into a 17. Now, where you have this problem in a transactional way, this is a fantastic case for some of the enterprise blockchain systems to solve, where you have cross-organizational syncing, the small amount of transactional data, where you both need a standing record, and you're trying to push some of that information into a database on both sides. So why did I spend all this time talking about Ethereum and mainframes and all these other things? Well, as it turns out, this was the very first type of blockchain computer that was then branched and cloned into all of the other enterprise systems that exist today. Quorum is a project out of JP Morgan Chase. It is literally a fork of the Ethereum code base with some additional edits and additional changes to be able to make it more enterprise ready. The changes that they made was moving away from a proof-of-work system into a voting protocol. So let's say you had 5 large financial institutions. You all wanted them to be able to interact with this private blockchain enterprise network. They would each register as an organization via some type of certificate mechanism, and then be whitelisted, and their IPs would be whitelisted to be the only ones to be able to interact with this network. Now, any one of these 5 banks can write their own smart contract, their own little application, and push it out and have other people call it and be able to interact with their own private blockchain. But it's no different than the systems we've just talked about. It's a peer-to-peer network with a blockchain database in the background, enabling someone to be able to perform private transactions but not have privacy on the network. So you will never You will always know who those 5 individuals on the network are, but the information contained within the transactions can have privacy if you're using the Quorum network. This is not the case for any of the public blockchain systems like Bitcoin or Ethereum or many of the other ones you've heard about. You can get privacy of the transactional data if Quorum is utilized correctly. Hyperledger is an IBM-sponsored project. Many of you may have heard of it in this room. It was kind of the second one on, it was the second one on the stage of enterprise blockchain systems. It is very familiar both functionally and logically to Quorum, though it does have some additional features, and there's many other people that are building on top of it to try and solve things related to both identity and privacy and transactional throughput. It has a membership service just like Quorum, where you have a number of organizations enroll. They get a public and private cert to be able to access, to be able to perform transactions on the network or publish what they call chain code, which is just another distributed application or a smart contract. And those applications run on your little private enterprise blockchain. It also uses a consensus protocol to be able to vote what transactions are valid instead of doing a proof of work or a proof of stake. And finally, it enables you to be able to create both public and private chains. So for instance, let's say that you know, with that group of five organizations you have on your enterprise blockchain, that you only want two out of the five to be able to see a transaction, or you only want three out of the five to be able to see a certain type of branch of transactions. You're conducting a different line of business with those other three organizations. So you don't want the fourth one or the other one to be able to see it. You have the ability to create some of those private side chains with Hyperledger. So more of these types of projects are emerging, but they all have similar properties, or they're all they're all trying to solve that same core use case of there's no central authority, but at the same time we want to conduct transactions amongst each other or with each other. For the moment, these projects and similar projects like it are focused on solving the scalability as well as the data throughput with less focus on identity and privacy, but that's still on the horizon. So right now, if you were to use a public blockchain system, your transactions might go through every 10 minutes or every 7 seconds. With these systems, their current throughput and current speed is around 50 milliseconds to be able to have those transactions go through, which is, you know, nowhere near something like a Visa scale network. But it's also a question of what your use case is. If you don't need to push 16,000 transactions a second across your little cabal of five banks or financial institutions, they'll serve your use case just fine. Additionally, the big core features that you can get from these is being able to identify every single individual actor on the network, and then also gate what kind of applications or smart contracts they push into the network that you want to potentially use. Now, I find this all incredible. As a history nerd, I find this all incredibly fascinating. We have gone from Assyrian traders who created a clay tablet ledger system 6,000 years ago because there was no central authority, to pushing those clay tablets up into sometime at some point paper. And then somewhere around the 60s or 70s, we took those reams of paper that were sitting in filing cabinets and started to shove them into mainframes. And I think this is where some of our thinking around the concept of needing a central authority to be able to do transactional processes sort of shifted a bit. We needed to have the database, we needed to have the cloud, we needed to have the one master record to be able to do some of these things. And we're starting to see that loop come full circle where you can say, all right, you know, I still need to interact with this set of organizations. It is either too costly, too time intensive, or too much of a legal barrier for us to create a single central authority. But we still all want to perform trade. We still want to perform commerce or transactions. And a fantastic use case of this is the media industry. If you've ever worked with the media industry, what you end up finding is that the royalty payments are a bit of a mess. Everybody is in some way, shape, or form involved in making that song or that movie or that book, but nobody wants to be the central authority for those payments. Nobody wants to take on the responsibility of doling out who's getting paid, but at the same time, everybody wants to trade. And so Ethereum, Hyperledger, and Quorum are all systems that help us solve that problem and start to say, all right, how do I perform distributed trade and transactionally across a loose set of organizations? So just some of the applied realities to take home for these systems if you're looking at integrating them into your enterprise. Enterprise blockchain systems are trusted platform for publishing distributed applications. These platforms are all the integration of a computer, a peer-to-peer network, and a database, usually referred to as the blockchain. Some of the more advanced systems have actually started to put a relational database on top of the blockchain to be able to do more transactionally efficient processes. Smart contracts are chain code that run on top of this platform. And fundamentally, the use case where that these solve is where there is no central authority, but there must still be trust between parties for transactional trade. Thank you for listening to me. My name is Adam Cecchetti. I would love to take any questions you might have.
So, two questions. One about what you just said. So, being a ledger, it only records historical activity, right? It provides trust about what has occurred, but not about what will occur.
Correct.
Okay. And then the second thing is, some of the folks I've been talking to about blockchain are like, we can use it to solve the identity problem. We can do authentication with it. And I don't see how, since it's about the past, and you ostensibly can't store proof of me in there that wouldn't be available to anybody else.
So those are two fantastic points and questions. I want to start with the first one, which is a ledger system is a standing record of things that have occurred. And with clay tablets, with paper records, with databases, that is absolutely true. The way that blockchain ledgers record transactions is a little bit differently. So a blockchain ledger will say, the person that can sign this next transaction is the one that owns this amount. So imagine that if you were to be given, six sheep, but the only way you don't have those six sheep at any one given time. The only way you could actually take those sheep and transfer them to someone else is that if you could prove via cryptographic signing that you're the one that is allowed to move those six sheep. So while classic ledgers do and blockchain does record transactions that have happened in the past, you can't have a future transaction unless you're the one that holds the key to have a future one. So you can, in fact, say that as long as you can prove to me that you're holding that key, you're the one that can, in fact, guarantee that those six sheep will go to me, or that bolt of textile, or that royalty payment for that media file, whatever it is, to get a little bit away from my history exams. And the second one is about identity. The most contentious arguments around blockchain, I believe, right now are in the identity space and in the authentication space. Some people think it is the best idea that has ever occurred. Some people think it is the worst thing that will ever happen to us. I have a bit of a contentious view myself here. My concept of identity is that there's two things that make up identity: all the things that you have done in the past and the person that you're about to present yourself as in the future. And in many use cases, you want to have a standing record of who you were to be able to prove that you can do something next. And in some cases, you want to let the past go. You want a second chance to be able to say, I am a new persona, I am a new person, I'm a new whatever that might be. And that second use case does not work in blockchain. Because if it's everything's public, if everything's available, there's no way to say, how do you have another identity in this system that's not tied to that old one? And before I rat hole too far here, it's more of a coffee conversation, but I think there's some great designs happening in the identity space around blockchain. The on the ground, how do you implement it, is just like many of the other things with blockchain, is where I think a lot of these things start to fall apart.
Okay, thank you.
In the case of the permission blockchains, who's the entity?
I'm sorry, can you step a little further than Mike?
Yeah, in the case of the permission private blockchain, mm-hmm. Who's the entity doing the whitelisting?
So the entity doing the whitelisting depends on the system. So in the case of Quorum, you have a membership service that somebody subscribes to. And then that membership service is something that's shared by the cabal of the individuals. And someone will say, yes, I agree that this is also one of the five institutions that's supposed to be on this. From a whitelisting of those, that's your own personal infrastructure, your enterprise infrastructure. So if you're saying that these four organizations are the ones that I should be talking to at these IP addresses, those others have to do that fully connected graph of all of these IPs are the ones that should be the ones transacting on this network. Now, there's hybrid models and designs, but for the most part, to answer your question more succinctly, the network is the one that's doing the membership and the permissioning and the gating.
So just a quick follow-up based on that. Mm-hmm. I've been struggling with finding the answer, mm-hmm. So I was just wondering about your perspective. Why is it not a distributed database problem, given this? And why not just solve it with Multimaster or some of the database technologies available?
So I think the biggest criticism of not just the membership system, but why do we even need an enterprise blockchain that has a distributed ledger boils down to, you know, we've had multi-master replication for our RMDBs for years. Why don't we just have replication across, you know, the five organizations of some type of distributed state? And the answer that, you know, I've talked to a lot of folks about, and we kind of sync back for, is that nobody wants to be legally responsible for the infrastructure that five organizations all have some kind of immediate access to and replication to. But I do think there are some use cases that enterprise blockchain is being pushed towards, saying, why don't I just replicate, you know, my Oracle or my MySQL database to your org, and we're kind of done here. At the same time, those types of systems, depending on how you implement them, how you roll them out, wouldn't allow a loose confederation of individuals to be able to push applications on top of that data. So while half of the use case is the data is important, as important is I want to be able to write some type of contract code or some type of loose legal contract or program that shares that data with three of those other companies. And data-based replication alone doesn't solve that problem.
Okay, thank you.
So I had a couple of questions. I mean, the previous question actually touched upon it. I mean, we have been looking at security use cases for blockchain. Mm-hmm. And almost every time it boils down to having a distributed database. I mean, why can we just not do it from a distributed database standpoint? Now, a couple of things that we looked at, and you know, sometimes it's a bit of a reach, is can we switch from a hierarchical PKI infrastructure to a more flat FIDO kind of a model? And this is very security specific, right? I mean, so there are enterprise use cases, but with respect to specific security use cases, we're struggling to find things that blockchain is going to help us with or dramatically change the way we do things today. It just seems to be more of a, you know, hammer looking for a nail right now.
There's in the security space for blockchain, I would agree. There's a lot of places where there's a little bit of shoehorning, like how do we put blockchain here, or you know, like how do we patch our systems with blockchain? It's two of the big things that I've talked to folks about in the past. One is not PKI replication for the network, but PKI replication at the root. So if you want to start looking at solving the, you know, how do we keep VeriSign and GoDaddy both from signing a certificate that happens to be, you know, x.com, and them having a transactional record of who owns the certificate signed for x.com, so that you can't have confused CAs, or you can have, or basically a less ability for there to be a malicious CA. That's one place I can see it potentially being applied there. That's some conversations I've had with other individuals that are around that, like, you don't want to have all of the transactions involved, but if you have, you know, say a loose confederation of city-states or a loose confederation of CAs, how do we make sure that we sync all together, but nobody wants to be the master CA that's tracking the list of where certs will eventually be signed? So, kind of similar to how AD does replication for force across organizations.
Yep.
It's very, very similar use case with the Atom databases, not to get too in the weeds. But coming back up, the other one that we've talked to some individuals about is, you know, you have a, not to give anything away, you have a large, very geographically distributed organization that has a ton of different devices and IoT sensors. How do you ensure that the things running on them or some of the information is coming back when you want to do snapshots across massively geographically distributed areas is what you're expecting? And so some of the other places we've
like a policy compliance, security posture determination, things like that, right? I mean, it's essentially
more like somebody drives past that manufacturing facility once every year.
Right.
Like, how do we know what's going on there, right? And my real answer to that is maybe you should plug that facility in and get more real-time data, but that's not always possible.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Thanks.
Yes.
I'm sorry, I cannot hear you. It's all right. No, take your time. Go to the mic.
Microphone.
So I have a question related to the inner working principles of Ethereum. So from my understanding, in order for the smart contracts on Ethereum to be executed, it's still going to be executed by the miners, right?
So the answer is yes. for the transactions to be performed across the smart contracts, the miners will end up executing that smart contract to be able to continuing along the transactional state. However, if I write a smart contract and I push it to Ethereum, there's nothing stopping me from calling your code in that smart contract by default. You have to do a lot of work and energy and effort to be able to say, my smart contract can't call yours.
So does it mean that if I want to execute my own smart contract, I have to have enough number of ethers?
If you want to execute your own smart contract for, there's two ways to see this question. One is if you just want to run your own smart contract, you can run it in your own kind of localized Ethereum sandbox. If you want to have a contract run, then the person calling that contract has to have enough gas, which is the secondary currency that runs, that is the amount of compute that that contract is going to use. And you would have to pay to run your own code in Ethereum if that were the case. So yes.
Okay, I see. So it's still solved by the money driven, right?
If you think about like early days of mainframes, people literally paid for hours of compute time to be able to run their batch files through them. And this is no different. You're putting together your program, you're putting it into the computer, and then you're paying to run it for a certain amount of time.
I see. So because the central problem I have, I don't understand, is how miners choose smart contracts to execute.
Just like any other, so the question is, how do miners choose smart contracts to execute? They don't. So the transactions are published to the network, and those transactions are queued up. Those transactions then identify a smart contract they have to run through, and then the miners end up running that transaction through the smart contract to be able to have the transactional state of both the contract and Ethereum be published to the chain.
I see. Thank you.
It's great questions. And Quorum works very similarly, except that you don't pay to run your own code on your own machines if you're an enterprise. So.
Hi, this is Pablo. You mentioned something about the opcode suicide. The question is, I didn't know too much about Ethereum, but because your smart contracts are immutable, they are forever in the blockchain. So if I know that I wrote a smart contract with a bug, the only way to patch it is write it a new smart contract with that bug fixed, submit it to the blockchain, get it approved, and then suicide the old one? That's pretty much the process?
A better analogy would be, that is absolutely correct. So just to recap that, if you write a smart contract and publish it to Ethereum, and there's a bug in it, you can't patch it, you have to kill it, and you have to write an entirely new smart contract and pay to publish it again. So imagine if you had a website that was running, and you found a bug in it, you would have to completely destroy the site and then publish an entirely new version that other people would use. And that's the state of the systems today. Some of the other systems like EOS and Cardano and some of the additional patches to things like Hyperledger are starting to look at how to fix this. But right this second, it's like minting ROM. You send that ROM to the factory, it gets manufactured, and then it goes out to everybody.
OK, but the transactions that are already executed with the bug will remain in the blockchain, right?
Correct. So if you have a transaction that happens in there and that bug goes through, those transactions go onto the blockchain, and they're also immutable. They're there forever. The only way to fix that, and it has happened in the past, is with a hard fork, which means you split the chain into two. And one history goes one way, and one history goes the other way.
OK, so last question. Mm-hmm. So the smart contract can't be executed anymore, but remains as a proof that exists, because if the transaction is still there,
that's a fantastic question. So to be able to verify those previous transactions, the old code still has to be there, which means you still have to be able to push that through. So the code, so suicide means that the smart contract is no longer valid, and anyone that calls it immediately exits, but the code remains.
Okay, thank you.
Fantastic questions. Anybody else? Oh, one more.
Thank you for that. I've been tackling, authenticating audio and video in a kind of world of deep fakes, and looking at blockchain technology in that process. When it comes to dApps, have you looked at, what ways there are to protect the IP? Is it only possible to do that with a private blockchain, and even, you know, with trusted parties? Or, you know, do you have to have a rethink of how you look at IP for public blockchains like Ethereum, things running on like a smart contract on Ethereum?
Right. So there's a couple of things wrapped up in that. One, now that we have made a global accessible network and can send content anywhere instantaneously, and anyone can edit it instantaneously, how do we understand what's actually real? And two, what does that look like in a blockchain type system? So there's an interesting analogy going around that the internet is for communication, the blockchain is for assets as to what the internet is for communication. That the ability to assign digital assets from one individual to another is the real killer use case, the real reason that blockchain continues to catch everybody's minds going, saying, previously, if I made something on a computer and I wanted to make a copy of it, or I copied it infinitely, I can never assign either the origin of that to an individual or have somebody pay for every copy of that, or assign every copy of that. And blockchain stops that. Blockchain says, for this copy, until you get it to the raw bits, to the analog of whatever it might be, is signed something on this chain, and I can trade it with you back and forth as a result, or say that my copy of whatever that is unique compared to someone else's. So in the world of like deep fakes, as well as what data do I trust that's being fed into the systems that I'm trusting? There's an entire huge branch of blockchain systems, what's known as oracles. So you have this corpus of data off chain. You feed it into some smart contract, or you feed it into some number of dApps or some type of machine learning algorithm. And then that puts some transaction on the chain to say that if you do this in a repeatable manner, you'll get the same output. So if I take this video that I captured at a news event, and I put it through this particular set of algorithms, it should have this hash. It should have this stamp on it at the end to say, this was the real video that I took at the real live event. If you're willing to trust that the copy that you got from me was from my cell phone, but now you can prove it. So there's a lot of work being done there. It's all alpha at best. It's all initial thoughts and ideas. Some people are trying to get some things bootstrapped here, specifically because of the deep fakes, specifically because of, you know, what information can you trust if it's infinitely replicatable and infinitely editable. I'd love to talk with you more offline, but that is an area that people are looking at. A thing I think is exciting is that if we're all going to have personal AI assistants, how do I know that the data they've been trained with is the valid data that I want to be able to trust if I want to have a trusted conversation about Mesopotamian history with my digital AI assistant? And I think there's a lot of interesting use cases in the blockchain space, similarly to proving validation of data is the either for training or for just news.
All right, fair enough.
One more.
Hi. I understand that the identity is not part of the blockchain, but do you know any project where identity is included into blockchain to maintain?
There's a number of different organizations working on this right now, some commercial, some non-commercial. There's a branch of the Hyperledger project, which I think is, I'm going to get this wrong, but it should be enough for you to Google. It's, I think, OpenNext2. It's an identity system built on top of Hyperledger that's being sponsored by some major corporate, has some major corporate sponsors behind it. I have not looked at it, to be honest with you. That's the biggest one I know of right this second. But many commercial organizations that have identity offerings are also looking at how do we integrate this in a way that makes sense for our customers.
Thank you.
All right, I think we're out of time. Thank you all for coming this morning and listening to me.